and Patty Lee.
And this is Andrew Chow.
Hello.
Yes, Andrew, are you ready to be wowed today?
Wow me, baby! Thank you. Let's see.
What do we have here? Ow! Whoa!
This is the rainbow flag.
Yay! Rainbow for leprechaun?
No, when we see the rainbow flag, we know that we're talking about the LGBTQQIAAP+ community.
Oh my god, that's a long word. And what does it stand for?
Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, questioning, intersex, asexual, ally, pansexual. And the plus is for everyone else because everyone's welcome.
Okay.
We sure we'll have subtitles.
Right.
Okay, English time, right?
Yeah, very inclusive. So let's find out a bit more on the tape first.
Let's go.
On May 17th, 2019, the Taiwanese government approved the same-sex marriage bill and made Taiwan the first country in Asia to legalize same-sex marriage. On the 24th of the very same month, 526 same-sex couples were married on the day the new law was implemented. And since then, Taiwan has received a myriad of global attention due to being LGBT+ friendly, and even being referred to as the gayest country by many activist websites. However, the first attempt for a same-sex couple to acquire a legal marriage status was rejected by the court just 33 years ago, a time when society was much more conservative. How did Taiwan then, in about 30 years, take the lead among Asian countries on the path toward gay pride? This achievement can't solely be attributed to the contributions of gay rights activist and pioneer Qi Jiawei, but also to the hard work of the Taiwan Tongzhi LGBTQ+ Hotline Association. In addition, the number of people participating in the Taiwan LGBT+ Pride has grown from 800 people in 2003, the year the event was first organized, to 200,000 people in 2019.
Love is love despite any gender or border.
What better place to celebrate Pride as like one of the only places in the world to do so?
Through this, we can see how Taiwanese society has progressed into one that respects diversity and inclusiveness over the years. 2022 marks the 20th anniversary of LGBT+ Pride, and this year, 120,000 people showed up to support Pride, despite the heavy typhoon rains and winds. And their message was simple. Taiwan is open, and you are welcomed.
Wonderful piece of history.
Yes.
Yeah.
A lot of my gay friends, they came to Taiwan and they say they love the people, they love the food and the hospitality. Being accepted in Taiwan is very, very important for him.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So, Tyler, you're from Canada, right?
Yes.
Yes. So, how is it in Taiwan? The community, the people?
You know, actually, I feel like the community here is much bigger than in Canada. I think maybe because of the population, like it's more dense, but I feel like in my hometown, there's only one gay bar and I'm living in the fifth biggest city in the country. So it's not like it's a small town, but it's just like not that many people come together like that.
Right.
Compared to Taiwan, it's like even you don't even have to just say like my community is gay people. There's like different, you know, maybe I want to hang out at Honglou or I want to go party somewhere else or I want to go to, I don't like nightlife. I want to meet some more people from my community in another way.
Right.
You can like find, there's so many different ways to find people and the community is so big and so like together. I think that is like very special to me because I didn't really see something like that like where I'm from.
And here, are there like some other lesbian friendly kind of joints and places and gigs?
Yeah, there is a true club in Taipei. It's one called Taboo and it's more like a dance club and one called Wonder. when there's more like a drinking place. I'm doing a girls' party like for the things 19 years ago.
Wow. 19 years.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Well, this is our first one, like girls' party is like 19 years ago.
Wow.
Yeah. But for Taiwan, they are like to doing like very like song dong, like only can let men or woman inside, oh. or no man or something like that, or all girls play very like crazy or something right. like that. But oh. they don't really mention like lesbian. They focus on like girls and girls kissing, and wow. there's a no
Some
any
more
man.
Like, provocative
not
headlines.
A lot of men entered, but by the time like right now, they're like improved to like we invite many like celebrity mm-hmm. or like okay. famous people, and
yes.
we're doing a lot of different kind of show in the drama, in the dance, yeah.
yep.
in the stage to just showing the how is woman's love.
More and more accessible and publicized to the public.
Yeah.
I've lived in Taiwan for 13 years, and when I first came here, it was the general social community. It was a lot more welcoming, of course, like going to bars and things like that. Everything was okay. But I started working in TV 12 years ago, and back in that time, it wasn't quite the same.
Well, what was it like 13 years ago for you?
In those 13 years, I've seen other people in entertainment like go on and be able to share with the people they love, their families, and I've never really had that myself.
Right.
So this year I kind of made the decision that for the first time I'm done hiding, so oh. let's just get out.
Yay!
So, thank you.
I yeah. love that phrase. This is my unlimited future.
That's because that comes from this year's Taiwan LGBT+ Pride theme.
Oh,
an
really?
Unlimited future.
Who was in this
did you guys
Pride
all go?
Parade?
Yes, I went.
You
yes.
were. You guys
you
go?
Went
I go like every year.
I think he did more than went. I didn't think he did more than go.
You work there, right?
I work as a volunteer for Taiwan.
Yeah!
LGBT plus
oh,
Pride.
So cute.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And they're like gold medals.
Right, it's Pride on Pride.
Yes. And then, so Taiwan LGBT plus Pride is put on every year by an association called the Taiwan Rainbow Civil Action Association. They have done every Pride since 2020, and that's the year that I joined. I started with the association because in 2020 I saw that their Instagram had fewer followers than mine. And I had only started doing Instagram. I was like, honey, something's wrong here.
Let me do something.
And then also that year, especially, and the years before, there had always been a lack of English information
okay.
available. So okay. Since those were things that I was working on doing YouTube and stuff, and Instagram, I figured I could help on that and then on the English stuff. Mm-hmm. And in 2020, they were looking for people who were volunteers to be hosts. Okay. So,
do you
as you can
just
see
come
here.
And
yeah,
no,
I'm good.
The chair's fine.
Find a way out.
So that year I got to host, and that was amazing because in 2020, if you remember, the pandemic hit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And usually Pride in most of the world is held in June.
Right.
But in Taiwan, we hold it at the last Saturday of every October.
Mm-hmm.
Throughout the year, most countries hadn't been able to hold their Pride. In 2020, we had 130,000 people
okay.
come out, which was wow. lower than our highest, which was 200,000 in 2019, the year that same-sex marriage passed, of course.
That's not even that much of a drop, considering. Yeah. 200 to 130.
Still yeah. so much.
And then the exciting part, so this year, I volunteer for the association in charge of public relations and publicity as the team leader, the Xing Xiao Zhu Zhu Zhang. And then I also work, like I just talked about, with the Color Taipei program as the Zhuan An Guanli, the project manager yep. for all of it. So I was helping plan everything in that. So it's been a busy year.
Yeah, yeah.
It's been a busy few years, yeah.
I actually personally haven't been to a Pride before. Mm-hmm. Like, what are some things that that you can see, or like some things that really stand out at Pride?
I had my first Pride in Taipei this year. And that was only my second Pride in my life. And it was like, I was shocked at how big it was, to be honest. Like, the first one I went to, I was 14 years old in my hometown.
Yeah.
And a lot of the content is the same. You can see, like, not naked, but almost naked people.
I like that.
That looks very nice. Yeah,
I like
right?
I like bodies.
Perfect for
Ming-ki-ki.
You.
Yeah.
Ming-ki-ki.
Chili beans.
What else? Yeah.
If I was to join for the first time in my life to a Pride parade,
mm-hmm.
what are the 4 must-dos? Do you have a list?
Oh, Tyler found some must-dos.
That's
yes,
a must-do. You
That's
have
a must-do.
Do that.
Good
yeah.
boy. Good boy.
And no, I'm
kidding. Oh. Family TV show.
Yes, that is a must-do. You have to take. Actually, that is from the condom brand, so must do get some free condoms.
Okay, yeah, that's important.
And then
safe.
While you're wearing your human condom because it's raining.
It's raining.
that place that I'm at is near the City Hall Center. Okay. There's a lot of like stalls there. You can, some companies set up like information booths or they're selling stuff. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of cool things to see there. I'm sure you know better than me. I was just looking at that.
Yeah, it's the rainbow market. And it's got companies, but it's also got NGOs in it. And lots of people wearing very little clothing.
Yes. Okay.
Because that's what sells.
Yeah, this is this year when we went to the gay pride.
Wow. Okay, look at you. Yeah.
But I've been to the gay pride like continue for like 15 years.
Okay. Wow. Okay.
So the first, I think the change is like, because Taiwan's gay pride in the 15 years ago, it's very like serious. Like we not with government before, like 15 years ago, 16 years ago, we combined with many, many topics, not only LGBTQ. It's so, with like the sex people to
sex
have
workers.
To work a lot.
The first time when LGBT plus pride was held in 2003, and it was put on by the Taiwan hotline, the Taiwan 同志 hotline,
yes.
Okay. Uh-huh. They thought that people would also be afraid, so they prepared 100 masks. At the end of the day, because they were worried so many people, that not many people would come out, they contacted a bunch of NGOs and women's rights, sex workers, associations, as well as like children's rights, education. They thought there would only be 300, and in the end, 800 people came out, and those 100 masks were barely used.
Wow.
So
wow.
Taiwan Pride, one thing that's super different about it than the Western Prides that I've been exposed to, at least, is that even though it's just an LGBT plus event, the entire community comes out to support.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And 2008 was the first year we had any actual sponsors. So before that, it was those other NGOs working together with their donations as well as donations from private citizens that made it
possible.
Yeah,
but like I go to the Canada or like I go to the USA's Pride, like it's more happy and with music, with dancing.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Yeah, some people before think that maybe not is so good, but I think for my own opinion, I think it is good because more like celebrity or like more company will support and join. That means LGBTQ group want more people to support together.
And what's really exciting is this year, for the first time, we had some of our biggest sponsors be Taiwanese companies rather than international companies. International companies have been supporting since the very first time it was an international company. But seeing Taiwanese companies come out and support, it's just,
it's very, very exciting.
This is exciting.
Wow. Yeah. This guy seems like he's seen quite a bit of history.
This is Qi Jiawei Lao Shi. He was the first person to come out on television, I think it was, right? On television years and years ago. And after, throughout the history of pride, the history of the walk towards same-sex marriage, towards equality, towards equal rights in general, Qi Jiawei Lao Shi has always been at every event and usually carrying a giant rainbow flag.
Wow, yeah. So he's like the father of the LGBTQ movement.
Right.
She's going to talk to the government.
Yes.
Right. So we need that, but go back like 30 years, this is like...
The government would think that you're absolutely out of your mind.
You're crazy,
how could you? Mm-hmm. Right. But now it's different.
It is.
By years, you know, we see the happiness that you mentioned compared to other countries. The Taiwanese Pride Parade is really happy.
Yeah, in Asia, we'll do the best.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Sure.
And what
but also
I
the
see,
social awareness, too.
Social awareness and creativity.
Right.
The creativity of what they wear, how you guys dress up, I think it's
how you
super
present
awesome.
Yourself to the world.
Yes, so they're basically artists, huh?
Yes. There's a little hint for you. We'll see you right after the break.
Wow!
Yeah!
Yeah!
How sweet!
Yeah!
Reading is basically a form of what we call shade. I love how everyone else stands out more than the host. It's so fun.
Wow Taiwan! Ladies and gentlemen, may we now introduce Dan Dan Demolition and Wicked Patricia!
Yeah! How sweet! Kiss me! you should, as you should.
My goodness.
Fascinated by your performances and the attitude.
Yes.
Well, look at you, Patricia.
I am fascinated by you too, how humble you are to dress down for your guests.
I know, I try very hard.
Thank you for noticing. Thank you for noticing.
What, can I try that on? I love this. Did you like this?
Well, I don't know if you'll fit.
I'm a little bit empty here.
Maybe you will fit.
Probably.
Yeah.
We've got a more similar build, right?
Right. Oh, yeah.
Drag artists.
Yes.
It's not an easy thing to do. It contains a lot of profession, right? Your outfits, your hairstyle, your designs.
Yes.
Yes.
You make your own clothing.
I do.
Okay.
I do.
I currently do not. I just don't have the facilities in Taiwan, although I have the skill, just not the stuff.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, she doesn't have anything to show. they're okay, but... No, yeah, I do make my own, all of my garments that I wear, usually.
Yes.
I do not design them myself. I usually come up with the idea and the whole concept for the outfits,
right.
But usually someone else helps me. Design them.
Okay.
So as you can see, that was my idea for that outfit.
Wow.
And if you are careful enough, we can come up with a little flag because this is our flag. We are non-binary.
Okay.
Both of us identify as non-binary.
Wow. The colors.
Like, yes.
Wow.
If you're like, where is the white? It's my skin.
Okay.
Does that work at white parties too?
Because, yeah, usually.
Just come out in your birthday suit.
I've just never been bold enough.
I have done that since the start of my drag career. Actually, I started doing drag in my birthday last year.
Okay.
Just last year.
Yes.
Wow.
That's impressive.
Work it, girl.
Wow, look at
you. Wow.
That was me last year, baby. Wow. Patricia.
A glow up, right?
Exactly. I mean, we'll never see that with you, but okay. On TV and we have never seen a glow up. Wow. But yeah, so actually like I did like a little princess, like my whole idea was like I want to be like a Barbie. Mm-hmm. And then this year I created my own outfit and then recreated the whole thing to up the game and show like my growth during that year.
Right.
Yeah.
What about Dan Dan? What about you?
I guess by costuming, in Taiwan at least, I focus more on sustainable ethical fashion. Mm-hmm. So I actually use, I repurpose a lot of clothing. We also do a lot of upcycling. So if you watched my feature on Netflix, you'll see a lot of the costumes. Those were custom made using secondhand clothing.
Wow.
So,
that's
yeah.
A lot of love. Yeah. Love for the community and for the environment.
Yeah.
Oh, Patty, wait, drag. I'm sorry, I hate to interrupt, but I hate to make our guests stand. Please, have
sorry,
a seat.
I'm just so into their stories and everything.
Wait. What are your names again?
My name is Andrew.
I am Patricia Patty.
Bye. Please, have a seat. Thank you.
Oh, what do we have here?
Oh, a surprise mystery. A box within the box.
Lucky draw.
Patricia, do you know what this is?
That's for all the people who go to drag shows. If you see something like that, put your money in it.
Okay. Then a box shows up.
Oh, yeah. My goodness.
Yes.
There you go.
Thank you. To help the poor. And more drag artists, people like us. Because we are poor. Oh, okay. Yes.
We are poor.
This is not cheap.
Yeah.
This is not cheap.
Yeah, me, I'm not cheap. But yeah, no, like drag artists, we as Dan Dan and I, we both usually try to make our own things and upcycle stuff, or we look for different ways so we can create the art and create the whole illusion and bring entertainment to people with as less money as we can, right. Because we also have to like eat and survive on our normal day-to-day lives. And in other countries, like people that do drag can make their whole career drag, mm-hmm. and they don't have to do any type of other jobs.
Right.
But here in Taiwan, it's not possible yet because we don't get paid much when we do shows. And the Taiwanese audience, because of the culture, they're not used to tipping.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So usually when we do like shows, we tell the audience like, okay, so you're in a drag show, so please tip the performers.
Yes, because yes, 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 take it. Well, as I said, I knew drag artists. They are actually a very difficult professional, you know, performer.
Right.
Yes, there's so much to do. And I have a good friend. He goes to the gay bars and have fun a lot. And he says the most difficult thing is lip syncing. And it's a very important thing.
It really depends on the artist.
I think it depends on the individual, yeah. Okay. I suck at lip syncing. I'm much more of a, I'll do makeup, costumery, and dance is sort of my strong point.
Okay.
Yeah, but not a great lip syncer.
Uh-huh. Right.
Then there's also like comedy.
Yeah, comedy too.
Like do hosting events and stuff like that, the ones that make you laugh.
And then there's people like me that do everything. And they're just good at stuff.
I've also heard of this one thing called reading. What is that exactly?
So reading is when you learn the alphabet and then you start like
making words.
Makes a lot of sense.
Andrew, do you read?
So everything I've been doing up until this point, I can do it.
But okay, so reading is basically a form of what we call shade.
Oh.
It's like little comments over there that are usually jokes, mm-hmm. and they're usually not mean-spirited, mm-hmm. but sometimes a joke is just a fact.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Sometimes a joke is just a fact. Ouch.
Well, that's just a fact, not a joke.
For example, I love how all of you are like wearing just comfy fashion, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I love how everyone else stands out more than the host. It's so fun.
Am I supposed to feel bad that I don't get
I think Patty's face is saying the
fact is just the joke and the joke is just
a fact. So we are jokes.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Finally you realized it.
I get it. Thank you.
But people have to understand, if it doesn't make people laugh, if it doesn't make people go like, oh my God, she really said that, you're just being mean.
Okay.
Right. What I've heard is supposed to be a little bit like kind of helpful, like kind of like tough love sometimes.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Like she told you your clothes is a little bit, you know, mm-hmm. can be better, so mm-hmm. next time it will be better.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's this kind of thing. Okay. Not necessarily, but I've heard among the queens, it's like, saying that, you know, maybe your wig, and then next time they know, oh, I didn't know my wig looks like that, so next time I'll do it better. Not you.
Do not look at me when you're doing those examples.
Oh, sorry, that was not a wig. Brian, fix your wig next time.
Oh, sorry.
Wow!
It's party time.
The girls' party called Find a Wife.
Find a wife. And they will dance for the whole night, and it's like they don't even get tired.
Talk about like in Taiwanese culture, like before we just more focused on like drag queen,
right?
But right now, like these 2-1 years is getting up more like drag king,
okay?
Like then I think drag king you are the most popular in Taiwan, but I think many years ago there is a drag king culture in transnational Taiwan, do you know the TV award? Jin Zhong Jiang.
Yes.
Yeah, this year is
the best male.
Best male
lead was won by...
is give to the female because she is in the drama, she's acting as a Da Qingjun.
Yes.
Chen Yalan. So I think if we put this like traditional culture in the like drag or drag culture, that's what we very.
Hey, my dad loves Peking opera.
Right. Mei Lanfang ma?
Yes. Yeah. So I've been watching that since I was a little girl. Yeah. And my dad usually says, hey, look, although he is a man, but his voice and his personality, his talent.
His persona.
Yes. And
everything about them on stage at that moment is woman.
And how beautiful he looks.
Yeah.
So
thank you for
amazing.
All those compliments.
Yes, of course. I'd love to hear about your story. Being in Taiwan and accepted in Taiwan.
I've been here in Taiwan for 4 years, and I came here to study. And in Paraguay, I am open to my family. They all know my sexual identity, my gender expression. My family knows that I do drag. But since I've came to Taiwan, I just felt this freedom, you know? Mm-hmm. Even in Paraguay, people will ask me, would you like to try drag? And I will be like, I don't know. But then I came here and I was like, someday, yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. And then on my birthday, I was like, I'm just gonna get in drag and I'm gonna do whatever I want.
Yeah.
And that was the first time that I was able to express femininity freely. Mm-hmm. And then hanging out with other drag kings and drag queens and hanging out with them, I actually realized about myself actually I am also non-binary. So finding community here was a lot easier, and finding love, just people who I can always go to. Yeah. If I am feeling some type of way, I know that these people are gonna be there for me.
So it has a lot to do with the Taiwanese hospitality or our culture?
No, they're all foreigners.
Okay. Oh.
No, not all of them.
I'm just kidding.
Say something.
Represent.
No, I think it does have a lot to do with the Taiwanese way of just embracing people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Since I came to Taiwan, I love dressing up. I love, even on my day-to-day life, I'm usually wearing some type of makeup, or sometimes I wear a kilt to school, mm-hmm. or I wear a puffy, my prince type of mm-hmm. Outfits that actually represents the transgender flag, if anyone mm-hmm. has noticed. Mm-hmm. I wear it to school and people don't bat an eye about it.
Mm-hmm.
They're just like, oh, cool. Go off. Sometimes they come and compliment me, I love this, I love that, but it's usually well-intended or out of curiosity, mm-hmm. which in, I don't know, I haven't experienced it in my country, but I sometimes imagine that if it was in my country, it would have come from a negative side.
Right.
Then, I'm sorry, you mentioned earlier that you were queer?
I guess I would identify as queer, yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry to be blunt. Could you maybe give me the layman? I don't know. Ah, now I feel awkward and embarrassed. I would like to know more. Uh-huh. Would you mind sharing with me?
I would like to know more.
Oh, okay, yeah. So, queer itself is sort of an umbrella term for everything that encompasses LGBTQA+, right? In English, queer used to be a derogatory term for anyone that wasn't cis-heterosexual. So someone who's cisgender, they align with the gender that they were assigned at birth, and they're heterosexual. So basically, mainstream, most people are like this. And so later it became a movement where some people in the community would try to take back the term queer. And so it became used more as sort of a term that we would refer to ourselves in. And I think it's a little more inclusive perhaps than, for example, LGBTQ, especially when you're not really sure where you fall within this huge spectrum of differing gender identities, different sexualities. Mm-hmm. There's also asexual people, agender people. So queer itself can just be a very inclusive term that encompasses everything that isn't just cishet.
The yeah. umbrella, no wonder you gave me an umbrella.
Yeah.
Yeah, the product.
Well, like Dan Dan said, queer is a really good umbrella for community, for anyone who may just, maybe doesn't fit into what would be expected to them by their biological gender or their sexual identity or okay. expression. Okay. As you said, it used to be derogatory, and right. what it used to mean was weird.
Right.
And so they took it, right. this meaning of weird, to come to be these people are not normal. And
sometimes if you watch movies, you can hear the term like, oh, that's queer.
Oh, he's right. so
An
queer.
An older fashion movie.
Yeah, like, yeah. oh, that's so queer that you do this.
And then it got turned into a derogative term.
I love your accent. You're so nice.
I don't love yours.
Oh,
I'm kidding.
That wasn't even reading. That wasn't even reading. That was just straight up.
You have to be careful.
I love this. I love this.
So I work.
Thank you. Thank you.
Girl, you sure believe that someone is gonna take your seat.
Oh. Typical episode to host. Oh. Yes.
No, I love. And I love everything about it.
It's party time.
It's party time.
Okay, now we have to go to the after party, which is a huge part of Pride. Did you guys go?
Wait.
Oh, so if.
So at 7 p.m.
Yes, the Pride ends.
So tell us more about the after party. What does that have?
Oh, the after party for me is the best part.
Oh, okay.
There's so many like nightlife in Taiwan, yes. especially Taipei for gays or anyone who wants to experience kind of gay culture. And there's a map. If you want to introduce.
Oh. So if you look at the map here, the red points are the lesbian bars and clubs in Taipei, and then the blue ones are gay bars and clubs in Taiwan. Like Tyler, I grew up in a smaller area. Like I went to university in Salt Lake City, and we only had one or two different bars open, LGBTQ plus bars at a time. And there, because we only had one or two, everyone would mix together. Mm. But then when I moved to Taiwan, come to find out that everything's a little bit more separated out. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The one I most like is the girls' party called Find a Wife.
Find a wife.
Mm. Yeah, this is before same-sex marriage allowed. Oh, so okay. we wish like we can find a wife.
Oh, yes. Okay. Yes.
In the first 5 years, lesbian right. bar is only open for women because that time lesbians more like
a small group.
A small group. Okay, yeah. Right. And then some girls, some lesbians don't like to play with guy, okay. even yeah. like. Yeah. gay guys.
Sure.
We can be good friends, mm-hmm, like drink mm-hmm. afternoon tea. Mm-hmm. But in the party or you know like a gay pride after party, we are separate because
some people have a mission.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Like a destination.
Motive. Yeah.
There's a motive.
There's a motive.
Years and years ago, when I came here first 13 years ago, it was very separated, where it was it's lesbian and yeah. gay. But then mm-hmm. more and more, there are more spaces that are more.
I think in Taiwan right now, it's more like remixing. But for right. example, when mm-hmm. I go to Japan, mm-hmm. they're very, very like separate.
Okay, right. okay.
I think it's pretty moving that they started, you know, 19 years ago.
19 years.
Started as a small group, but now, you know, everybody's celebrating together.
Yeah.
Oh yes, that's me and my coworker at Pride. So what a lot of people did after Pride is go to Honglo. It's really nice to, I guess, pre-drink. You okay. have some drinks. And I really like the kind of atmosphere there because since it's like open, everyone kind of mingles together. You can. Yes. It's a really good place to meet people. Mm-hmm. It's not too loud, so you can chat. And you can just stay there and drink the whole night, or you can go to kind of club after. Right.
Okay.
So one of the more famous clubs in Taipei is famous for dancing. The first time I went there, I was like amazed because everyone is on the stage doing the same choreography, and they will dance for the whole night, and it's like they don't even get tired. Wow. But they're all, and the stage is so small, but everyone is up there.
So
I was like, oh my gosh.
Oh, and not only that, but they've got the choreo down.
Yes.
They could all be background
dancers. It's a professional show, sounds like.
It's like, you look and you're like, how can these people all be doing the same dance at the same time? And they know all, like, the song changes, and I know this song too, they keep dancing.
So it's like, it's almost so choreographed that it has to be practiced and rehearsed.
But nobody, like, I've never heard anyone getting paid. Yeah, exactly.
Okay. And if you're not so good and you're standing close to the front, then the other dancers are slowly move you back.
Oh, really? Because it's a show.
It's right.
Like me, I always get pushed to the back, but whatever. I have a good deal with everybody else, so.
Don't worry.
Bye, guys.
How's it go?
Wow!
What does that look like? A souchong? Is it?
Oh,
is
I bring.
Oh, wow.
It was pretty tight. But for the gay and lesbian group people, they can go and look for love as well.
There's actually one that's really special in Taiwan, and that is the rabbit god shrine. The god there is supposed to kind of be like the gay Yuan Lao. Yes.
It's a privilege to be in this community. Mm-hmm. You know, you feel the pride, the warmth, and everybody together, right? Mm-hmm. Can we hang out together with them? Are we allowed?
Of course you are. Yeah. Everyone's welcome.
Of course you are. The entrance fee sometimes is higher for women, unfortunately.
You get no fee.
Do I get charged?
Double. What's double of free?
You know where you will both be welcomed and you will have
no difference at? Prison?
No, a drag show.
Okay.
You can come at any drag show and you will both pay. There's no difference between genders on how much you pay for a drag show.
That sounds very fair.
Yes.
And you'll get entertained, you'll get a free drink most of the times with your ticket.
Yeah. Just remember to tip.
Just remember to tip.
Tip is very important.
Must.
If you want more, you will be cursed. Like, yeah.
I don't think it's necessary, but okay. No,
she's a witch.
In Taiwan, I actually have a lot of lesbian friends. In Taiwan, we call them tea. Right?
Yes. Like tomboy.
Tomboy, yeah. Short for tomboy. And they are very conscious about their body figure.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
About what we call them, su xiong.
Especially, I would say like su xiong is from Taiwan. Taiwan made.
Oh, really?
We are binders. We made it.
I had no idea.
It's like all the English
really?
Binders.
But right now, like many my friend in mainland or Europe, they come Taiwan to buy the su xiong.
What does that look like, a su xiong? Is it Oh wow!
It's pretty tight.
This is very comfortable.
Oh.
I usually wear this kind.
She wants to try it. Yeah. She wants to try it.
Because, but you're wearing a sweater.
I don't think you need to, honey.
I'm just gonna feel it, the material.
See, that's why the LGBT community is fun, is because some people can say things like that.
Hey, my gay friend always says, Patty, don't turn your back on me. So used to the meanness, yes.
Wow.
We're not mean.
You're gay.
We're not mean. It's our way to show you that we love you.
Yes.
All right. You just said it was for self-improvement. What are you talking about?
That was Tyler.
Okay, very
good. Don't blame stupid things that come out of people's mouths on me.
Small boobs is fashionable. Dan, I love your body figure. So in Taiwan, we combine these culture, our traditional culture, with the gay
and Beijing opera, all the way to the first people coming out and representing their...
And combining our traditional culture, temples, to ask for love.
Yeah.
Like in Taiwanese culture, we go bye bye a lot.
Definitely.
Yes, and we go seeking for love. Yes, but for the gay and lesbian group people, they can go and look for love as well in Chenghong Miao.
Right.
Chenghong Miao. And yes, usually people ask for the red cords to hold on their hands. To find love.
Right, when you go to the Chenghong Miao, you pray to Yue Lao.
Yes.
The one who is supposed to help you find your true match. Yes. But aside from that, did you know that Yue Lao can also help you find better prospects for work and make you more attractive to people on the business side of life?
Wow. I didn't know that.
That's why I went there.
You talking about my clothing or?
Oh, the shade.
So it's good for everybody, right?
Right, for love and then also just for interpersonal relations. But then there's actually one that's really special in Taiwan, and that is the rabbit god shrine.
I haven't heard that before.
That temple is maybe more commonly heard about in Tyler and my circles because that's a place where the god there is supposed to kind of be like the gay Yuan Lao.
Oh, wow.
For a gay couple.
That is so cute.
That's so cool.
But I heard a more common use of this temple is people will just go there and open their phone, go on a dating app, and that's how they meet their match.
We're using both the new and the old ways.
Mixed together.
That's a good idea. I'll try.
Yes.
The gods have to update with the rest of us.
So I think whether you're in the community or not, I think the Taiwan society is so warm mm-hmm. so loving, mm-hmm. and I think accepted to everybody,
yeah.
right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
For sure. Over the last 13 years, seeing Taiwan going from a place mm-hmm. where it wasn't as open and the different communities didn't interact with each other as much, to the point where now we see all of the wonderful people in the community coming together and standing up together, I think that all of us kind of can see that it feels like Taiwan's ready to finally celebrate the LGBT plus community. Yes. And it's an
amazing thing. I love the phrase, love wins.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have a long way to go still, though.
There are a lot of troubles and trials ahead of us, for sure.
Yeah. Yes.
Because mom, after the gay and lesbian marriage a lot, mm-hmm. but there are more and more issues we need to still need to focus.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
For example, where women are not allowed to artificially inseminate their own eggs that are frozen, yeah. even mm-hmm. though the government pays for the freezing, there's subsidies for that. Okay. Also, there are issues with transnational couples. So if one of your partners comes from a country that isn't accepting of gay marriage, Taiwan will not recognize that union.
I see.
Yeah, right. And there's also a lot of issues with adoption. Yeah. But
even in the community itself, it's still very cis and binary.
Mm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Where we see usually for the big parties that are targeted to queer people, it's still very I love how I was hearing you guys in the background. It was annoying, but still I was hearing it. And you guys were mentioning about the hot muscle guys and things like that. But that image doesn't make all of us comfortable. Mm-hmm. And for me, I don't feel comfortable looking at that usually. At least in public, or when I see an ad for a party where it has that image, I don't feel like it's for me. Mm-hmm. And I don't feel like me as a non-binary person, I am welcome to those places. Mm-hmm. So lately we have been, a friend of ours, Dandan and I's, her name is Anya Leon, and they created this group called It's About Them Time. It's about bi time. Mm-hmm. And it is a gathering each month that it's including everyone who's queer, that is transgender woman, trans man, everyone that is basically outside of the binary, and woman, and gay men are welcome if they are very respectful of us as well. Mm-hmm. So in spaces like that, we feel a lot more connected and we feel more accepted.
Even in I've only been here for 3 years, but only in this short amount of time, gay marriage was just legalized not that long ago, and I feel like things are improving quickly. So mm-hmm. Even though there, of course, is still many problems,
right.
but I can see that things are changing too, and hopefully it will continue to improve. Yeah.
So I see a lot more drag now, for example, as well. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There's so many more people trying drag, mm-hmm. and there are so many more people open to it now.
Yeah. Yes.
And you see sometimes on the MRT, and people are okay.
They're getting
so
used
that
to it.
Happened, yeah. but I'm yeah. moving on with my life.
Yes. Yeah.
So
yes.
I get a lot of those looks, and I actually love them.
Yeah. But hey, together we are stronger, yeah. right?
And we're starting the conversation.
Yes.
Yes.
So, thank you all for sharing your stories and
you
your perspective. Mm-hmm. We're heading forward.
Yeah.
Doing
yeah.
a
we're
lot
heading
more.
Forward. No. Heading yes. for agent.
Yes.
Right, right, right.
So, and this is for your information. You guys are so important for this fight as well, because we need the allies.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We need us alone, we cannot do it by
ourselves. I'd love to see Andrew drag.
I would love to put him on drag. Or Dandan,
us
together. Let's put him on drag.
For the next episode.
We can do a special episode, yeah.
Yes. Wow.
For the people watching, if you want it.
Thank you guys for joining us.
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
We'll see you next time.
On Wild Taiwan. Bye.